the loss of lobbying at the Assembly of State Parties over the Kenyan cases, and the D-Day is tomorrow. This is KTN Prime, the top stories tonight.
There is no division whatsoever.
We will expect within the first five minutes of sitting at the Teacher Service Commission to be assured that teachers have been paid their salaries.
Kenyan teachers union leaders mend fences ahead of talks with teachers' employer.
The wheels of justice grind slowly. Eventually, justice will come to the victims.
Now, I think the British and the most of the Europeans are really buying the position that we are engaging them with.
Moment of truth. Kenyan delegates lobby ahead of Friday's debate on Kenya's agenda. Welcoming the Pope. Final steps ahead of next week's papal visit to Kenya. And Paris attacks. French authorities confirm Friday terror mastermind has been killed. Welcome to the program. William Sila is our sign language interpreter. Tonight, I'm Linda Ogutu. The Kenyan delegation at the Assembly of State Parties intensified lobbying ahead of tomorrow's debate on the Deputy President William Ruto's case. The delegation met high-ranking Assembly of State Parties officials to raise concern over the conduct of the International Criminal Court in its handling of the Deputy President's case. Kenya got an assurance from the ASP President that her proposal will be granted ample time for debate on Friday.
Kenya spent the better part of Thursday to crystallize support on her case before the Assembly of State Parties. The country faces a critical moment Friday when the ASP debates Kenya's plea to reverse application of Rule 68 on the use of recanted evidence in the Ruto case, as well as establishing an independent bench to audit the prosecution's case. Kenya's delegation of Foreign Affairs Secretary Amina Mohamed and her defense counterpart Rachel Lamamo, backed by National Assembly Majority Leader Eden Duale, met the Assembly of State Parties president to raise concern over ICC's handling of the Ruto case. The Kenyan delegation adamant that the trial chamber erred in admitting Rule 68 on the use of recanted evidence to be used in the Ruto case.
We feel the way even it has been put in 2013 does not allow the judges to use recanted evidence. So we are asking for a clarification. Number two, we are asking for an audit of how the witnesses in the Kenyan case were procured, were sourced, and were maintained at the ICC.
The country was putting her best foot forward in a charm offensive to collapse the ongoing Ruto case, poking holes on the conduct of the ICC. Pokot West MP David Kosing also presented his petition seeking the termination of Ruto case, citing flaws in the investigations and picking of witnesses. Kosing, whose petition was signed by 190 MPs from across the political divide, saying the petition is crucial as ICC has been accused of witness coaching and procurement.
The Assembly agrees to appoint an ad hoc mechanism of independent jurists to audit the prosecutor's witness identification and recruitment process in the Kenyan cases. Those are the two results that we want at the end of the day tomorrow.
We think that it's time now that we need the Article 112 mechanism, that is oversight of the process of the ICC, to be put in place also, so that then we can have we can know the whole truth about how the case started, how witnesses were procured, and the manner in which the court has conducted itself.
In her diplomacy ahead of the debate, the Kenyan delegation also met the ICC chief prosecutor Fatou Bensouda to register her dissatisfaction on her handling of the Ruto case. Bensouda has been critical of Kenya's onslaught, saying if allowed, the ASP would be meddling with the judicial independence of the court. It was a busy day as the country's delegation sought to bridge any gaps, including meeting with the civil society organizations.
We must be allowed to engage in dialogue within the Vienna Convention. The Vienna Convention, if you read, allows state parties to be engaged, to be given their space.
Yeah.
If that's not allowed, then we will talk to the country tomorrow.
Friday's debate poses a critical moment for the Ruto case. Should the ASP delegates uphold Kenya's proposals, the case against the Deputy President William Ruto and radio journalist Joshua Sang will be suspended. But should they fail, Kenya, whose position has the backing of the Africa Union, has threatened to lead a continental mass pullout from the Rome Statute. Sam Ogina, KTN News.
So as Kenya battles to save Deputy President William Ruto and radio journalist Joshua Arap Sang from ICC prosecution, the ICC Chief Prosecutor Fatou Bensouda has stated that although the ICC justice system grinds slowly, it does grind, and both the suspects and the victims will get fair justice. Bensouda spoke exclusively to Reuters at The Hague.
All the things we are now thinking of, the children's policy, and going towards even if the court in the first 10 years to take the cases that I want in Libya, I want them to also look into the alleged crimes. That ideally, I think the thought about 16 in the exercise model is because of that model, we'll be able to absorb it.
We have the capacity to do that, but there was no political will. And as a member of the ICC, if they do not do it, the prosecutor can use proprio motu powers initiative to take a case there, because we say no longer impunity, it's not an option. I know that the wheels of justice grind slowly, whether it is at the international level or even at the national level. It grinds slowly, but it does grind. And I believe that what is important is that eventually justice will come to the victims. This criticism does not match the reality. This is really what is important. It is a blanket criticism because, yes, it is true, I will not disagree that all our cases that are in trial are from Africa. This is true. And all the people so far that are in the dock are also from Africa. But I always say that let us step back and ask, how did they get there? Africa brought cases to the ICC. All the cases that we have, Except Kenya, Sudan, and the Libya, all of those cases were at the request of African states asking the ICC's intervention. Obviously, the what is happening in Syria for now, I think 4 years, is quite serious in terms of alleged crimes that are being committed. But because we do not have territorial jurisdiction, I must say my office is not looking at it. We don't have territorial jurisdiction, but we do have personal jurisdiction over the nationals of state parties who happen to find themselves among the ranks of ISIS.
The ICC Chief Prosecutor Fatou Bensouda there. The D-Day for Kenya is tomorrow. Let's see how she will argue her case tomorrow. We're keeping an eye on that for you. Let's bring you back into the country now. Leaders of the Kenya National Union of Teachers have today put up a show of unity to dispel recent reports of cracks after a state house meeting last week. The union leaders have now agreed to obey a presidential directive that they and the Teacher Service Commission hold talks towards a new collective bargaining agreement.
It's a handshake meant to erase recent reports of cracks forming within the country's largest teachers' union following a meeting convened at State House last week. The Kenyan head of state intervening in a matter that saw the country go through a 5-week teachers' strike, which left learning paralyzed in most public learning institutions. NAT Chair Mudzanzili and the Union Secretary General Wilson Sosion now presenting a more united front following days of accusations and counter-accusations over the true intentions of the State House meeting. Oddly, Sosion had been left out of the loop.
There is no division whatsoever between us, because the teachers of Kenya brought us here not to work for ourselves, but to work for them.
There has been no war at NAT headquarters. There has been a very strong ideological thinking to move the union to the next level.
The union agreeing to hold talks for a fresh bargaining agreement with the Teachers' Service Commission on the 25th of this month, but not without a caution to the teachers' employer.
We are warning TSC, prepare and prepare well. Prepare and prepare well, so that we can close this business once and for all.
The union has insisted that they will head to the talks with nothing less than a workable collective bargaining agreement that should see an end to the teachers' pay disputes. They insist that they will accept nothing short of a 50% to 60% pay rise. They also expect payment for their September salaries, as well as the union's dues that they insist TSC is still unwilling to release.
We are not going for collective begging. We are going for collective bargaining agreement. We are not going to sit to be instructed. We are going to sit to agree. And we are not going to start from zero. This is a matter that has been ongoing.
NAT has also welcomed President Uhuru Kenyatta's intervention, but maintains that what they will be bringing to the negotiation table next week is nothing new, but rather what they have been fighting for all along.
We will expect within the first five minutes of sitting at the Teacher Service Commission to be assured that teachers have been paid their salaries, and we want to confirm by this weekend that teachers have actually enjoyed their salaries.
Solidarity forever, for the union makes us.
And so the song, so common on every teacher's lips, continues. This time, with officials hopeful that by the time the union holds its annual delegates conference this December, they will have a new collective bargaining agreement to present to their 190,000 members. Timothy Otieno, KTN News.
Well, it's just a few days before Pope Francis makes his way to Kenya. Of course, all Catholics are eager, looking forward to that visit. That coverage of that visit begins now on KTN Prime. It is now less than a week before the historic visit by Pope Francis to Kenya, and preparations to welcome the Pontiff are in top gear. The altar that will be used by the Pope to conduct Mass at the University of Nairobi grounds arrived in Nairobi this evening from Nyeri. The altar, which is over 100 years old, is the same one that was used during the historic beatification of Sister Irene Nyatha Stefani in Nyeri in May this year. Chocolate in color and made of hardwood, it was constructed by the Consolata missionaries soon after their arrival in Kenya over a century ago. The base of the altar has various engravings, among them the Holy Eucharist, a bird feeding its hatchlings, a dove, a fish and a lamb. It is 8 feet long, 3.5 feet wide, and 3 feet high. The altar was received at the Holy Family Basilica by members of the Pope's visit secretariat.
Preparing Mass ahead of the celebration, then they have to put in place the necessary furniture, the necessary items that we need at the altar. So indeed, we do well ourselves as part and parcel of the secretariat to indicate to our people, in fact this is a learning process, that the place of the Mass is not only the podium, but there is very necessary furniture, and that is the altar.
Let's now still focus on the Pope, and we bring you the story of Kenya's first Cardinal Maurice Otunga. KTN's Dorcas Ongira narrates the life and times of a man on his way to sainthood from his native town of Bungoma in Western Kenya.
He was born at the end of January 1923, the son of a paramount chief and a diviner, one of his many wives. They named him Simiu, one born during the hot and dry season, but his father later changed his name to Otunga, which translates to a staff that supports the old and the lame. 1923 was the year of the Devonshire White Paper that recognized that even in the uncertain colony with a great Catholic missionary presence, the genuine owners of the land would eventually rule themselves. Little did his parents know that their son would join the church that would make him one of the most revered men of God from Kenya. This Eskata area in Bungoma, South Bungoma County, a humble place but home to two great men, the paramount chief Joseph Peter Sudi, who was buried here, and his son Maurice Michael Otunga, who was born here. The chief wanted Ayanga Otunga to follow in his footsteps, but Otunga was bent on serving God, and he went on to become the first Kenyan archbishop, the first Kenyan cardinal, and well on the way to becoming the first Kenyan born saint.
Recognize our identity. I am a Mbukusu. I cannot deny my Mbukusu. But to be a Mbukusu, to correct my Mbukusu, God became a human being in order to save us.
Ordained as a priest third October 1951 in Rome, he later returned to Kenya, keen on evangelism and being a servant of God's people, not just in the country but the larger faithful in East Africa. November 1956, he was appointed as the auxiliary bishop of Kisumu, the first Kenyan to be elevated to the episcopacy. Philip Sulumeti, retired bishop of Kakamega, was a man close to him and notes that it had been hard for him. The church was human and the acceptance of him as a black bishop was difficult in some quarters. Kenya, then a colony, and the settlers had the mentality that they were going to stay.
I blessed our independence. The politicians of today said we have brought our own bishop.
March 5th, 1973, 2 years after taking over the See of Nairobi, Archbishop Otunga was made a cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church. He was cardinal when John Paul I and John Paul II ascended in succession to the papacy, both in 1978. George Michumo, the bishop of the ACK Church in Bungoma, is his maternal cousin.
It means quite a lot will come from, and that is the expectation of the people. Unfortunately, they tend to concentrate in Nairobi and other areas and forget at home. And I simply think that Cardinal Otunga, having that kind of saintly qualities, perhaps he thought by developing home, people say, I'm tribal.
As cardinal, he was guided by the principle that the line between the religious affairs of the church and the civil, political, economic and justice situations of the country was of distinction and not separation. Known for his humility, he never hesitated to defend the poor and the marginalized. He was the voice of reason and never shied away from using his moral authority, pointing out the shortcomings of the Kenyatta and the Nyayo administration, the false lines of the 844, the assassination of Tom Mboya, corruption, shady business deals, and the infamous Magendo of the late 70s. His immediate family was large. They knew him from afar. His brother Christopher Kilali Sudi was born when the cardinal was 24. He says his brother was a pious man to the core.
Vitu kama maskini alitoa. Vitu kama ufisadi ndio hakuwa anataka kabisa.
Mary Nyongesa Sudi fell in love with and married his brother Robert Nyongesa Sudi.
Nitachiru wacha nioleka hapo. Na huyu semechi yangu alikuwa mtu wa kanisa Sainti.
Pope John Paul II visited Kenya three times, 1980, 1985 and 1995. Cardinal Otunga had asked to resign in 1991, but John Paul II refused, appointing Bishop Raphael Ndingi Mwana Nzeki of Nakuru, who would succeed him automatically at the time of his retirement or death. His final years were punctuated by illness, and with a great sense of dignity and humility, Cardinal Otunga spent his final years at Mumbai Wazee, a home for the elderly in Kasarani, operated by the Little Sisters of the Poor.
And perhaps, who knows, when Pope Francis comes to Kenya, he might now decide to announce that Maurice Cardinal Otunga will be due for sainthood. And that will be the joy of the church.
Very important to everybody, and especially also lifting the profile of Kenya as a whole.
Revered in life and in death, modest, as eulogized by the Most Reverend John Njenga, the Emeritus Archbishop of Mombasa, 5 years after his death. He was a cardinal, a potential pope to be precise, yet he never made it his habit to call to attention everything that he did. Dorcas Wangira, KTN News, Bungoma County. He was born at the end of January 1923, the son of a paramount chief. Linda, here in the North Rift, the NOREB, North Rift Economic Bloc, started today officially, bringing together 8 counties of the North Rift with investment opportunities for not only local but foreign investors. And I'm joined on set here live from Eldoret, the home of champions, by the city of champions, by the chairman of the NOREB, His Excellency Honorable Jackson Mandago. Thank you for joining us on set. If you could tell us directly now, why NOREB? Why bring about the 8 counties?
Thank you very much, Mercy and Linda. First and foremost, let me say that the North Rift Economic Block comprises of the 8 counties of this region. That is starting from Samburu, Baringo, Elgeyo Marakwet, Uasin Gishu, Nandi, West Pokot, Trans Nzoia, and Turkana County. The reason why we decided as a region to establish the North Rift Economic Block is to ensure that anybody who wants to do business or invest in this region has a seamless transition from one county to another. The purpose of this economic block is to ensure that we provide a conducive environment that makes it easier for any business person to do business in this region.
And I've seen, Governor, that the theme is unlocking potential investments, not only in North Rift, but acting as a gateway to East Africa.
Definitely. North Rift, we say, is the region of unparalleled opportunity. This is the region with resources that have never been exploited, and therefore it gives any investor who wants to invest an opportunity to start afresh with us. This region indeed is a gateway to East African region, because from here you can go to Uganda, Southern Sudan, Rwanda, Burundi. We are served by the international highway all the way from Mombasa to Uganda. We are served by the railway all the way again from Mombasa to Uganda to the central of Africa. We also have fairly good air transport in this region, and in fact, beginning next year, we are hopeful we shall begin having flights from Eldoret to Entebbe International Airport. And therefore, this region is not only a gateway, but actually a center of logistics for trade within the East Africa. For partners trading with Kenya, particularly the members of the East African community, they all transit through Eldoret. And we are seeing as a region, our trading partners from Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Tanzania, have no business going all the way to Mombasa or Nairobi. We want to give them the opportunity right here in the North Rift. They can do their business here and get back to Uganda or Rwanda or Burundi.
Governor, even as we wind up, a lot of positive stories from some of the counties like Turkana County, oil, water, you know.
Yeah.
But in the same manner, there has been concerns about insecurity. What assurance are you giving investors as they come to the North Rift?
Mercy and Linda, in fact, what we are referring to as insecurity is what we have dealt with as leaders. And in fact, as we sit here in the North Rift, we are actually looking for investors in film industry. We want to watch that you are calling insecurity in the films now, and you may not hear of them. We have commitment as the leadership of the North Rift to ensure that this is safe, but we also want to say that North Rift is a safe place to invest. In terms of security, we are up to date, and we want to assure any investor who comes to this region that their investments are safe and secure.
Safe and secure. The investment conference ends on Saturday. Investors from Sweden, we've seen, and investors from Germany, around the world, and also local investors. There, as you've heard it, Linda, for those who are able to come to Uasin Gishu County, and you know, even the youth, women, and local and foreign investors are able to come to the Eldoret Sports Club. Tomorrow there'll be more discussions. The event ends on Saturday. North Rift Economic Bloc Investment Conference. Joining us here was His Excellency Jackson Mandago, the chairman of NOREB. Back to you in studio, Linda.
Mercy Kandia, live from Eldoret, says the forum ends on Saturday. Mercy, thank you so much. Now, an oil spillage at Kibwezi in Makueni County, which was exclusively exposed by KTN News, has for the third week now continued to draw sharp reactions. The Senate Committee on Energy, which had toured the affected areas, has now demanded that children living within the vicinity of the oil spill must be screened for possible poisoning. The committee, chaired by Baringo Senator Gideon Moi, further warned that all the affected residents must be adequately compensated. Murimi Mwangi has the details.
This visit by 4 members of the Senate Committee on Energy is the second high-profile delegation to tour Thange Village in Kibwezi, Makueni County, in the past 2 weeks since news broke of massive damage caused by an oil spill from a pipeline managed by the Kenya Pipeline Company. and the committee chaired by Baringo Senator Gideon Moi is now concerned that children living in the area may have been infected with diseases arising from contamination of the water by oil.
Watu wote ambao wana uzisika, raia, wananchi, watoto, wako shule na hawako shule, wangekaa hapa na kupimwa kila moja wao. Sio kusema atilete sambo ati 20. No. Kila mtu katika village hii yote, vange yote ward, aje apimwe.
Nataka pipe, yani maji, watoto wapate ile maji safi. Wananchi waendelee kupandelea mashamba zao, lakini mashamba ambayo ile iko safi, hakuna ile ugonjwa ambayo imeingia. Wamama waendelee na biashara zao.
The committee also announced that it will in the coming days constitute an independent assessor to evaluate the extent of the pollution caused by the spillage and recommend solutions.
We are demanding that we bring food to them. Ama hiyo maji mutapika nayo nini?
Mimi nitapatia Senator Mutula Kilonzo Junior tanki mbili kubwa sana. Yeye akuje aweke hapa kwenye hizi shule zenu mbili ya secondary na ya primary. Wakati sisi watu wazima tunangangana na kutafutana mahali ya kukunywa maji safi, at least watoto wetu tuwe tunajua kwamba wanaweza kuwekwa maji yao ambayo inatokana na pipeline wapate mahali ya kukunywa.
Commitment kwamba hili ajali lililotokea mwezi wa tano na ikaadhiri watu wa eneo hii, lazima tuwe nanyi tuhakikishe kwamba tumefanya juhudi zote zinazotakikana.
The recent rains experienced in the area has seemingly spread the hazard to new areas as the contaminated water continues to mix with more fresh water sources. Among those affected are close to 800 pupils and students from Thange Primary and Secondary Schools. The hope of residents is that the compensation will be expedited so that they can rebuild their lives. Muremi Mwangi, KTN News, Nairobi.
He was born at the end.
Keeping it KTN, time for us now to take a look at business, and we'll begin with what's happening in the corporate industry, where Kenya's corporate culture has for years been driven from the top down with limited opportunities for employee engagement. As Ashley Missouri now reports, Kenyan organizations are beginning to appreciate how building synergy among workers boosts productivity levels and customer services.
Kenya's corporate culture has for years been driven from the top down with limited opportunities from employee engagement. But this is however changing as Kenyan organizations begin to appreciate how building synergy among workers boosts productivity levels and customer services. According to a survey from Deloitte, good corporate culture comes with huge dividends, with companies witnessing a 90% jump in their stock prices and 76% jump in net income over a span of 10 years. On the other hand, companies with bad corporate culture only grew by 0.1%.
In order for organizations to endear themselves in any way to an individual, it's key that they give that person a voice in terms of how they're experiencing the workplace. And that's really what the Best Companies to Work For survey does. It allows people to share how they're experiencing their day-to-day workplace.
Despite this, a majority of human resource and business leaders survey claim that their firms lack adequate programs to measure and improve staff engagement. On top of this, the country still has a shortage of qualified talent, which has contributed to a revolving door as firms jostle for talented but disgruntled people. The firm also says the practice of luring talent with higher pay is also not panning out, as people are becoming increasingly expensive and it also does not guarantee loyalty. Instead, Deloitte is urging organizations to make work more meaningful, foster great management, establish flexible working environments, create ample opportunities for growth, and establish trust, vision, purpose, and transparency.
The new scheme, as Deloitte unveiled results of the fourth best company to work for survey, Chase Bank was named the employer of choice in Kenya. The survey measured parameters such as leadership, fairness, and equity and operational effectiveness, among others. Ashley Mazuri, KTN Business.
And the full effects of a move by the National Treasury in June this year to lower duty on sorghum is beginning to pay off. According to industry players in the beer-making business, sorghum output has shot up by 28%, indicative of the uptake for malt in the market. KTN's Abia Gina reports.
The once popular keg beer that was all the rage with low-income earners is making another comeback after the state lifted a 50% excise tax imposed on the product in 2014.
Very glad to note that the taxes have been reduced, and as a result, the demand for sorghum has tripled this year, with tax revenues from Senator growing by 30% during the last 3 months.
The recent entry of brewing companies to use white sorghum for brewing has been increased production, has seen increased production of varieties such as Gadam and Sila. Here the sorghum has increased by 28% from 170 hectares in 2009 to 2,000 hectares in 2013. And the production has also increased from the 1 million in the same period to 1.8 million bags. Yeah, that's how it has really improved.
And the jump has boosted smallholder farmers growing the crop around the country as demand rises. EABL says it has renewed contracts with over 25,000 sorghum farmers that will increase the brewers' uptake from the current 20,000 to 22,000 tons.
The sorghum partnership has been a success story.
The crop had faced a slump in 2013 following the introduction of a 50% excise duty on Senator Keg, a low-cost beer manufactured using sorghum, as it sought 6.2 billion shillings in tax revenues. The tax doubled the price of the beer and precipitated the reduction in sales volumes, forcing ABL to suspend most contracts it had signed with farmers and costing the government 3.3 billion shillings in indirect taxes in the process. But in a reversal of the policy, President Kenyatta assented to the Alcoholic and Control Bill Act, which reduced the excise duty on beer made from sorghum, millet and cassava by 90%, making it more competitive for brewers to use the crops for beer. The renewed enthusiasm in sorghum could mean better days ahead for not only farmers but beer drinkers as well. According to EABL, farmers stand to earn at least 24 shillings per kilogram produced compared to 17 shillings offered previously. According to the 2015 economic survey, the government earned 19 billion shillings from excise duty on beer last year, a 13% increase from the previous year's 16.8 billion shillings. Abia Gina, KTN Business.
That's it for KTN Business, but for more news, log on to ktnnews.com, and also after the hour, you can join me for Inside Somalia. Do stay tuned. Up next is Sport with Moses Wahisi.
A good evening it is, and welcome to today's edition of KTN Sports. My name is Moses Wahisi. After what others have termed was a pure struggle, a dejected national football team, and that is Harambee Stars, jetted back in the country this afternoon from Cape Verde. The Stars lost 2-0 to the Blue Sharks, and despite the challenges that they faced before, during and also after the match, Coach Bobby Williamson subscribed to the efforts made by his charges.
A crestfallen Harambee Stars side touched down at the Wilson Airport around 3 p.m. from Cape Verde, where they failed to make it to the third round of World Cup qualifiers after they suffered a 2-0 defeat to the Blue Sharks. The players' body language showed a team that seemed dejected and let down by the government and their federation. The team's departure on Monday was marred by a series of delay and unpaid allowances. forcing the team to touch down 3 hours before kickoff, and they paid dearly for the federation and government's poor planning.
It's not ideal preparation. You can see that in the first 10 minutes we could have been down 3 goals and the game could have been over. But credit to the guys, they dug in and they got into the game.
The long hours journey, about 22 hours, coupled with stopovers at Entebbe, Kano in Nigeria and Dakar in Senegal to refuel. Lack of proper meals and enough rest showed as the team lacked pace as they went down to the Sharks. Stars captain Victor Wanyama did not travel back with the team, but instead opted to fly directly to England to rejoin his club Southampton.
The game starts from the mental preparation of a player. It's not all about that that's happening inside the football pitch. Also what happens outside the pitch matters. So we were a little bit affected psychologically, but I can't say that's the reason we lost.
Even as the team prepares for other tasks ahead, it is clear that their World Cup dreams were dimmed by their federation and the government's poor planning. After missing out on World Cup qualification, Harambee Stars' focus will now shift to the CECAFA Senior Challenge, which begins on Saturday in Ethiopia. Abula Ahmed, KTN Sports, Nairobi.
I know people have blamed Sammy Nyamoya for what the team faced, but also the sports cabinet secretary Dr. Hassan Wayo is partly to blame for mismanagement of this team. Now moving on, Bristol Rugby in the United Kingdom is the host of the Kenya's Shamas Rugby Foundation under 16 team. 22 players and 4 officials traveled to Bristol where they are engaged in rugby fixtures and also clinics geared to improve the players' skills. Shamas RFC is a team of teenage young children from an unprivileged Nairobi neighborhoods, including Kibra and also the Mathare slums.
Bristol Rugby lost the Shamas Rugby Foundation under 16 team that left for Bristol for a 2 weeks rugby action. The team, comprised of 22 players and 4 adults, will be hosted by 11 families of pupils from St. Bede's Catholic School in Bristol and the Bristol Rugby coaching staff. The Shamas Rugby Foundation under 16 team will first play against Rugby Festival on November 23rd before facing Clifton College on 25th of November.
So what we're trying to do is get the kids involved in rugby from the age of 6, 7 onwards, so that by the time they reach that 14, they already have a firm grasp of the game.
Shamas Rugby Foundation is using the values of rugby to teach life skills education to the boys and girls living in poverty in the urban settlements in Kenya, and with that they give the young stars and starlets a reason to smile.
Tangu niingie rugby sikuwa najua kitu yote. Vile nilianza kutrainiwa na Coach Mary, ndio saa tukachaguliwa, ndio saa kukuja KCA University, tukatrainiwa, sasa ndio saa tumechaguliwa kwenda tour.
I feel so excited because it is my first time to go up country, and also I am the first in our family to board a plane.
This is the third tour for Kenya Shamas young rugby talent, with the first one being in South Africa in the year 2013, the UK in 2014, and this year it is again a trip to the UK by the invitation of the Bristol Rugby.
The Safaricom Next Generation National Trials entered day 2 at Nyayo National Stadium, with aspiring young footballers hoping to make it to the Professional Dreams Academy. Day 2 saw the under-15s and under-16 players take to the pitch for the trials, after the under-12s, under-13 and under-14, and the female groups held their trials on Wednesday. 180 players were shortlisted from various counties, and only 75 will be selected to join My Professional Dreams Academy in January 2016. The names of the final 75 selected players will be unveiled in the first week in December.
Hapa Kenya kuna talent. Na ni vile ni wadami wanafaa kuja angalia hapa nje vile kuko. Kuna talent sana kwa vijana wadogo kama sisi mayus, kuna talent. Unafaa tuangalie tu vile MTD imefanya. Imekuja kutafuta talent, najua wakipata watakuwa wamesaidia watu wengi mtaani.
These trials I've tried it from Kisumu. Nilijaribu huko Kisumu, then niliweza kuchaguliwa kuja hapa. Ndio tulikuja hapa. Tena nimeona hapa ni mzuri. Tumecheza new generation inapeleka watu mbali.
And after the international break, the English Premier League action resumes this weekend, and there will be 8 matches on Saturday, where Watford is going to be taking Manchester United. Chelsea is going to take Norwich. Remember, Chelsea has been struggling, currently in the 16th position, and they hope to redeem themselves against Norwich. Everton will be taking Aston Villa, a side that has also been struggling and is currently placed bottom on the log. And remember, in the Everton tie, Romelu Lukaku will want to be the 5th player to having scored more than 50 goals in the under below the age of 23. Southampton will be taking Stoke City, and also Swansea will be taking Bournemouth. West Brom will be taking Arsenal. Arsenal currently second of the log, having tied with Manchester City, who are going to be taking Liverpool in a tie that either of those sides is going to emerge victors. Tottenham will be taking West Ham, a side that has also been very impressive in the bottom in the past few matches in the English Premier League matches. The last tie that will be taken on Monday is Crystal Palace is going to be having a very tight battle against Sunderland, another side that has been struggling, having accumulated only 6 points in the English Premier League log. That is just some of the matches that are going to be scheduled for this weekend. And also El Clasico is going to spice a lot of people's menu who love soccer during this weekend. My name is Moses Wahisi, and with that we wind up for today's edition of KTN Sports. Do have a lovely evening.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, is where we leave it on KTN Prime. Thank you so much for watching. I'm Linda Ogutu. Have a good night. Remember, tomorrow you'll have Betty Kyalo Okari with Friday Briefing. Have a good night.